Good evening, everyone. The schedule is 8 o'clock. It's my fault I was late. I had to deliver mezuzot to someone. People do not know how many mezuzot they need in their home. They told me 6, 7. In the end, there was 18, three times more. It took me some time to figure out, to go upstairs, downstairs. Mezuzot you need to put in every door, except bathrooms and laundry room if you have children with diapers. If no diapers, the laundry room is big, meaning the size of a room, then it needs mezuzah also. Basement needs mezuzot, basement door needs mezuzot, side door that you don't use coming in and out of the house also need mezuzot. Every second you don't have mezuzah in a door that need mezuzah, you're canceling mitzvah from the Torah, every second. And every second you have mezuzah, it's mitzvah from the Torah. 1, 2, 3, it adds to billions. But that's not our topic today. As Baruch Hashem, today should be a, Bezrat Hashem, hope we're not misled or live in illusion, but should be a very, very good day for the Jewish nation today, as the miracle that Hashem made to us, that Trump won the election. As you know, in a WhatsApp, it's been running for the last month that the codes in the Torah predict that he will be the president. The problem was that the media, the lefty liberal media, was brainwashing the people so much nonstop that from thousands of polls that they had, not one of them gave him a chance. Not one. Now one of them reported that he's leading, all of them is behind, 12%, 8%, 15%, 16%, 4%, but they never say that he's leading by few percent, any of that. They have their agenda. They wanted to brainwash his followers that he's losing anyway. Don't waste your time going, waste 2 or 3 hours going to stand online. He has no chance. This is what they do. That's the reason they've been doing it. And because for them it's the biggest nightmare that someone like him will win the presidency of the United States, which we're going to explain in a Torah way. Why the world was so afraid of him, all these media and liberals, why they're afraid so much that someone with his opinions will become a president with the power. We'll get to it. So the idea was that they kept brainwashing the people, that some of the people who knew according to the codes in the Torah that it would be elected, they were afraid to talk about it. You know, because what if they're right? It cannot be that thousands of them, they're all wrong, right? All of them comes to the same results. First of all, I doubted very much. I always had a big doubt about all these surveys and polls. They're not accurate. They're just not accurate. In the election in Israel, they said that the lefties are winning Netanyahu by 8% a day before the election. And overnight, he won the election. They were so far from the truth. You know what it is, 8%? It means hundreds of thousands of people, they made mistakes. It's not real. It's all waste of money, waste of time. It's all publicity. It's hidden advertisement. It's all corruption. All these polls, you can never rely on it. You never know. Plus, on top of it, many of the people lie. They don't tell them who they vote for. When they come and they ask who you're voting for, let's say they vote for Trump, they don't say Trump, they say Hillary, to let them live in illusion that they're doing good. Like this, they try a little bit less. So many of the people don't say, or they just enjoy to lie. Some people, without lying every minute, they cannot pass the day. So therefore, what they say, it's not realistic. So many people don't say the truth. One way or the other, let's try to understand what really happened here in the world. First of all, you know, as I told you, we are in a special year 777. 777. If you come from Nisan 7 months, you come to Cheshvan, which is this month. And what day of Cheshvan it was? The seventh day of Cheshvan. 7 months from Rosh Nisan, HaChodesh Hazeh Lachem Rosh Chodashim. 7 months, 7 day, and a year 777. I don't have to tell you what's the significance of number 7, right? In the eyes of Hashem. all the important things in the Torah in the world happen by sevens. Why? Shabbat 7, Shemitah 7, Holiday 7, Passover 7, Sukkot 7, everything 7. Why? This is the way Hashem runs the world. This is a very key number. On top of it, most of the people in the United States, they still don't have any idea what we got saved from. Why? You may ask, what's so bad about Hillary Clinton? Okay, she has liberal opinions, you know, she's Democrat, she, you know, but what is so bad? What really, it wouldn't be the end of the world. I'd rather Trump win, but she's not hating Israel, she never declared that she's an anti-Semite, you know, she's okay, we can live with her. The answer is absolutely not, and I'll tell you why. For over 22 years, she has her right-hand man that knows all her secrets. No secrets between them. It's an Arab woman, Uma, her name. You heard about her? Uma? Uma, Abidan, what's her name? The last name, I cannot pronounce her name. Uma, huh? Listen carefully. This Uma, she was married to a Jew, liberal Jew, Mitbolel, Anthony Weiner, the one that was caught sending all kinds of improper pictures on the internet. A Jew that married this Arab woman, Uma, Muslim, that she comes from a Saudi family, or the royal Saudi family, that sponsored September 11. You know that they sued Saudi Arabia in a court here, and they won that Saudi Arabia was behind September 11 attack. They threaten Obama, if they will allow it, Saudi will take all their investments in America and disconnect the relationship with them. They couldn't afford the damage, so they shush it. Now they're not talking about it. But who was behind September 11? Saudis. Which Saudis? The family of Uma. Who is Uma? The real president of the United States, almost. If Hillary would become the president, this Uma has tied to terrorists, to Al-Qaeda, her family is in link with all this terrorist organization. You have to see a documentary about them, you won't believe it. She received, thanks to this Uma, many, many millions of dollars from Qatar, Abu Dhabi, Bahrain, Dubai, all these countries that wants to own the presidency of the United States. How are they going to own her? By giving her many millions of dollars to the Clinton Foundation. The Arabs invested a lot of money in Hillary Clinton, not a penny in Donald Trump or Giuliani. They know who they can buy, who they cannot buy. If she would become the president, she would owe them so much. Who would pay the price besides America? The Jews, as usual. Always the Jews pay the price in the end. And the state of Israel. All the emails, that's all this controversy about her emails, thousands of emails that she's used on her personal email and server, they all got it from Weiner and Uma, from their computers. They didn't catch her, they catch them, they caught them. And from that they found out about all the emails which went to the enemies. Many of them went to the hand of the enemies. We don't know what the enemies know about United States because of those emails. In any other country, she would be sitting in jail for many, many years. Jonathan Pollard gave Israel little secrets about the nuclear development of Iran. He never told an Arab country, he did not tell an enemy of the United States, he did not tell it to the Russians. He wanted to protect his country, he's a Jew, he wanted to protect the Jewish state. So he gave Israel secrets because he was working in the United States. And America did not want to give Israel what they were obligated to give their allies, information about Iran. So he went and gave Israel this information. They put him in prison for more than 20-something years, almost 30 years he was in prison. If he went to prison for 30 years, she should have gone to prison for 500 years. But of course, don't expect, you know, justice here. It's all corruption. Many of the things. This is a woman that was bragging on live show on the radio while she was a lawyer. She was a criminal lawyer. She protected a rapist that raped a 12 years old girl and ruined her life. She protected him in prison. She knew he's a rapist. She admitted in a live show. I heard the recording. The host is asking her a question and she's bragging. This is what she said. Every blind person saw that he's guilty. It was written guilty all over him. And I still was able to get him free. She was bragging about it. She almost became the president of us. She would ruin our life. She would rule our life. This is the woman that almost became a president with a nice, sweet smile and all the fake hypocrisy. We almost fell into her hand. But all of the above, of course, is very dangerous. Imagine this Uma would become either the Secretary of the State or one of the most powerful people in America. She would have access to the CIA information, to the classified information, to all the American spies, to all the American agents, which is thousands of them all over the world, to all their list, to all the secret military base of United States all over the world, to all the developments of the weapon. All the power of United States will be in the hand of an Arab woman, a family of those who sponsor September 11. I don't have to tell you what would be the next move, right? So Hashem Mamash saved us against all odds. Unfortunately, the majority of the people in this country are liberals, as you can see. In New York, she won without a fight, Bichlal. There's no point to even vote here. She won in California, the same thing. New York and California, where all the educated liberal God-haters live, people that hate gods, automatically goes to Democrats, especially like Obama and her. After 8 years of disaster with Barack Hussein Obama, after 8 years of disaster, we almost fell into another 4 or 8 years of another disaster, which will be a lot worse. To see their faces, how they shock, they don't understand what fell on their head. Nothing pleases the normal people more than this. To see the faces of Aman and Achashverosh and all these people over there, how they cannot understand how all their plans smash into millions of pieces. But if you think it's in America like this, wait until you hear in Israel, all over the world, besides the Arab world, all over the world, in Europe, in Israel, in the United States, all the media, all the channels, all the televisions are all lefty liberals. Think about it. All the reporters, all the directors, all the owners, either it's owned by Arabs or by liberal Jews. Think about it. That they'll do anything they can to promote the Arab Palestinian and the Arab terrorists and the refugees and do everything they can to bury Israel. Everything. It's either Reform Jews, conservative Jews, Jews with no faith. Those are the kind of people who control the media and Hollywood and all these places who bring destructions to the world. And now what happened in Israel? When the reporter, all of them lefties, pro-Arab, Hamas, Palestinian, hate religious Jews, hate rabbis, hate Hashem, hate Torah, hate everything Jewish. Erev Rav 100%, like the Zohar warned us from these people. The poison of the world. You have to see how when they got the results of the election, how they were holding their tears. This woman, her name Yonit Levy, she almost cried. She started to mumble. I cannot believe I'm saying it, but Donald Trump is the new president of the United States. She almost broke in tears. And all the reporters and all the hosts, everyone is in shock, the shock of their life. It's like they just lost their son or something. That's how they look. Mamash, we don't look like that in Tisha B'Av like they looked last night. Now you tell me why. May I understand American Democrats when they cry that their hero Hillary and her husband Bill, with all his sites, you know, business, they didn't move back into the White House. I understand why some Americans are disappointed. But please explain to me why Israelis are crying that Barack and Hillary did not continue to control the White House. Why? Did you ever think why? I'll tell you why. In Israel, you divide the country to two halves. Same thing in America. The normal half and those who either live in illusion or they're just vicious, malicious, evil, Erev Rav. It's two halves. Some of them naively, they are in a negative side. They're naive, they live in illusion that one day you can make peace with Arabs and the Muslim one day will have mercy on us and they'll become civilized and they'll shake our hands and we can make agreements with them. They live in illusion, fine, but at least they're mistaken. They're not exactly bright. They don't understand the mentality of the Muslims, so they dream that one day maybe will be heaven here. You know, keep dreaming. But then it's the other ones who maliciously doing it. They know there's never going to be peace. They are the servant of the Satan. I made once a whole lecture about them. Meshartei Satan, the servants of the Satan. This is their job, to destroy this world as much as they can. But Israel is divided to two halves. You have the right, which is include almost all the religious people, even though some religious people also on the left side, believe it or not. But at least 90-something percent of the religious people are on the right side. You have the right side, and you have the secular Israelis, the ordinary, simple people. Many of them are not even educated, meaning college degrees, that understand who the Arabs are, they understand what Islam is, they understand what this liberalism is, and they go to the opposite side. But then you have all the lefties, all the authors, the songwriters, all the TV hosts, the professors, many of the teachers, all these people that don't understand what Muslim mentality is. No matter that they saw already tens of thousands of Arab attacks on innocent people on the world and massive bloodsheds that they create in the world, and that the Arabs continue to promote their agenda and their dream one day to slaughter every person in the world, unless if it's a fanatic Muslim murderer, everybody else will die, and they keep hearing it, but they keep ignoring it, and they keep giving their life to help these Arab terrorists to take over Israel. So when the lefties in Israel found out that Barak will not be followed by his help, by his helper, Hillary, which is the same mind, same ideology, that was the worst day of their life. What's gonna be now? There will not be a president in America that will force Israel and choke them to give more land to the Arabs, like all the other presidents did. Even the ones who were friends of Israel, such as George Bush and even Bill Clinton, they were friends with Israel. They didn't hate Israel. All the time from Jimmy Carter until now, all the president put massive pressure on Israel. Massive. The friends. Jimmy Carter wasn't a friend. He was the biggest anti-Semite. But besides him, all the other presidents, Reagan, all these people, they didn't hate Israel. But they were all politically correct. They don't want to get the Arabs angry. Therefore, they have to be 50-50. Yes, Israel has the right to defend itself. We're tired of this nonsense. But as soon as Israel make one attack and kill two murderer Palestinians, right away, wow, you went out of proportion. When they kill 500 people, or they bomb a wedding and they kill 300 Arabs, we apologize. We did not bomb in the right place. That's it. When Israel killed two murderers on the way to kill someone, and accidentally they kill another Muhammad who are clapping for them, they're going crazy with the hypocrisy. So what happened? Obama was the worst. Don't forget, in a war against Hamas, Obama stopped the weapon supplies to Israel in the middle of the war. It never happened before. In a Yom Kippur war, Israel was about to be destroyed. God forbid. That's it. Moshe Dayan, the Minister of Defense, he said, this is the destruction of the third temple, meaning we are finished. They already had a plan to put atomic bombs on a plane and commit suicide with all these Arab murderers. That was really the plan. That's not, they're going to kill us in a few hours, all of us. That's it, they're taking over Israel. Everyone was in shoes, Yom Kippur, there was no media like today, no smartphones. They had rotary phones in maybe 5% of the homes. Most of the homes did not even have telephone. There was no cell phones. There was only radio and one channel television, and it was Yom Kippur, so all the media was off. Nobody even know that the Arabs are already all the way in Israel, all over. They taking the country. In another 4 or 5 hours, that's it. They'll be in Tel Aviv, every block. What are you gonna do? Egyptian tanks, Syrian tanks, Jordanian tanks. It will be the end of us. We wouldn't be able to get them out anymore. That's it, they're in the country already. What happened? Israel needed weapon. They came to Henry Kissinger, the liberal Jew, the Jew hater. Henry Kissinger. He was the minister here in America, one of the top three people. The Jew. His brothers and sisters are about to get another Holocaust in Israel. He refused to give them weapon. Who gave them weapon? The Goy. What was his name? Ford. What's his name? Not Ford. Who was there back with the Kissinger? The Goy. Not Weinberg. I forgot his name.
Haig.
Alexander Haig. Thank you very much. Alexander Haig. Goy. Not Jew. He owed nothing to the Jews. His heart didn't let him, or let all the Jews, now thousands would die every hour. He supplied massive trains of weapon that help us to win the war and survive. The Jew didn't care, and the Goy sent the weapon. The same thing in Israel, you have at least 2 million Henry Kissingers like this, which are 10 times worse than him. They wouldn't mind that the Palestinians will take over the government and sit in the Knesset. They'll be happy. They forget that as soon as it will happen, they will be the first one they will slaughter. Why? Because they're all anti-religion, they all dress provocative, they're all full of tattoos, they all have all kinds of horrible gay marriage agenda. Who the Arabs hate the most? These kind of people. Do you think the Arab will be grateful to them that they promoted their agenda and let them take over Israel? They'll slaughter them in a minute. What's the proof? Germany. Here, Germany. Now there's a war in Syria. 500,000 Arabs died over there. Of course, nobody in the world cares, besides some fake statements that they do here and there. Nobody really cares. Nobody condemn anyone, no one condemn Putin, no one condemn Hezbollah, no one condemn Assad, no one condemn the rebels, no one condemn anyone. Just let them kill each other until the end of days. Nobody really care. It's all hypocrisy. If they care, they could stop it a long time ago. They don't care. It's all according to our own interest. Syria, Russia will sell a lot of weapons. Good, let them waste the weapon. We're making millions of dollars every day, why not? They care that Syrian dies. Putin cares that Arabs die. Putin cares about Iran. They really care about them. They just want customers. How are they gonna make money? Oil is down now. They must sell weapons. Billions of dollars of deals they sign with them all the time. They sell them all the weapons, all the airplanes, all the tanks, all the bombs, all the bullets, everything. All Russian engineers, they're all in Iran. They build the nuclear places. Don't be surprised if the Russians gave Israel the secrets to attack Saddam Hussein. Don't be surprised if they sold them out. They build it for them, then they say to his bombmate that we'll have another customer now for the next 20 years. This is how dirty it is. I'm telling you, it's very dirty what's happening. This double agent, there's a lot of things behind the scene. And most people don't even dream that it's happening. So half of these people in Israel, they don't understand that as soon as they take over, they will be the first one they slaughter with their children. They will rape their women. They will not have a drop of mercy on them. Never. How do you know it? In Germany, France, they open the doors for them. Come, refugees, come. We'll make you places to live. We'll give you food. We'll give you clothes. We'll welcome you to our country. We'll give you citizenship. Before they even come to the countries, they already announced, don't forget the brothers, the Muslim, the soldier of Allah. When you get to Germany, don't be blinded by their hospitality, they scream. Make sure you remember our agenda. Slaughter them all. Now, your friend said to you, listen, my friend and his wife, has needs a place to sleep. So he say, okay, I'm gonna open my living room. They can come sleep in my house until they find a place. Then someone send you a video that this guy and his wife, they make a video that when they come to your house, the first thing they want to do is to slaughter you and your children. Would you let them in? But they're miserable. They're on the street. It's snowing soon. What do I care about this? I'm going to die because they're going to be outside? Because somebody kills them? What is it my business? I don't get it. What's happening in this world? Don't you understand that as soon as you let them in, you're finished? You are finished. France is finished. England is finished. There's no way to clean the situation. Here comes one normal person. Individually, he made every possible mistake he could with his behaving, with the women, with the immigrants, with Mexico, lots of baloney. 90% of what he said he should have not said. We all know it. He messed up his own agenda. He could have done it without this big mouth. A lot of the things he said was not necessary. But some of the things he said was very disturbing to the liberals. The liberals cannot live when someone declare and say, I won't let Muslims into the country until we will verify 100% who they are. If they are a threat to our country, I can care less if they die in the country. It's not my problem. I will only let them in if I know 1,000,000% that another threat to me and my children and to my neighbors. That's my job as a president, to protect this country. What's wrong about it? They butchered him for that. Racist. What does it have to do with racism? And if it would be Japanese enemies, it would be the same thing. He's not saying it because it's Arabs. Any kind of threat. If tomorrow we're going to have a war with China, we're going to have to be careful if we should let Chinese people into the country. The enemies are declaring that they want to destroy you and your culture. Why in the world are you going to let them into your country? We are good people. We want to teach hospitality, morality. But the Torah does not say that. God say, be merciful to the decent people, not to the murderers, not to the terrorists. You should have mercy on a rapist. Have mercy on a pedophile? Are you normal? Where is the mercy coming from? The Gemara says someone who has mercy on cruels, guarantee to be cruel to the merciful, to the righteous. Guarantee. That's what happened. These liberals, lefties, when one Palestinian murderer from the Hamas get killed, they go to their parents to eat with them and drink with them Arab food and comfort them. Muhammad, we're so upset for your son Saeed. One day we will take over and then we're gonna be peace here and we're all gonna sit like brothers and sisters. And this Muhammad think, yeah, right, as soon as it's gonna be, we're gonna be in power here, first thing we'll do, we'll chop your head off. We're gonna be here in peace. You know what's good about the Arabs? They deserve admiration for a few things. Listen, we have to be honest. We have to be honest. The truth is above everything. The Arabs deserve a huge admiration for a few things. For what? One, they're not hypocrite. They say the truth in your face. We will slaughter you all, no matter what you're going to do. You're going to be righty, lefty, you're pro-Palestinian, you're against Palestinian, you love Islam, you hate Islam, doesn't matter. You're a Jew, you're an American, we'll kill you all. You're European, we'll kill you all. It's just a matter of time. They're not playing double face. When they look at you, you see right away that they want to kill you. They're not hiding it in their eyes, whether it's in the airport, whether it's in the elevator, whether it's on the street, anywhere. They're not showing you a smiley face. How are you, Mr. Jew? Wow, so nice to see you. No. Soon as they look at you, right away. If you go to the Olympic Games, soon as they find out that the wrestler is a Jew, refuse to go to the battle. Never not to talk about shaking hands. They're not going to shake a hand. No matter what happened, they lose. They lose the medal. They waited 4 years for that moment. They trained 4 years for that moment. When they do the lottery, the Iranian has to go against a Jew, or he found out he's Israeli, he's not showing up. Or Egyptian, not showing up. 30 years peace with Egypt, peace! It's not showing up. One of them came to the fight, he did not shake the hand of the Jew. The Israeli guy is begging him to shake his hand. Look at him like a dog. I won't shake your hand. Even in Iran, in the time of the Shah, when they're not brainwashed like today, after Khomeini came and what happened over there in Iran in the last 30 years, in the time of the Shah, the Jews live like in America. Railed, connection with the government, free life, freedom of religion, everything. There were Muslims, I know, I spoke to some older Persian Jews. Said there are some places in Iran, you come to a place to buy something in a store and you know you're Jewish, he wouldn't take the money from your hand. They say, put the money on the desk, you dirty Jew, and then I'll take it from the counter. Not gonna take it from your hand. Even in Iran back then, not to talk about now with all the brainwash that they go through, they're not hiding it. Barely you're gonna see hypocrisy by them. You don't see. It's not like the Europeans or the Americans, they come to the elevator and they see Fatma with Ahmed in her hand and Muhammad, her husband. Hi, how are you? It's a lovely day. And these Arabs are so disturbed just looking at this Christine or whatever, or the Jewish woman. By them, they have no two possibilities. Their book brainwashed them. Leave until you kill everyone, even if you have to die. You die, good for you, you go to heaven. That's what they believe in. So all the lefties in Israel, the liberals, it's a horrible day for them. You have to see some of the things they're saying today. It's the end of the peace chance, agreement, oh, peace. In the last 30 years, every week became worse than the week before. Every week became worse. Not one week there was an improvement in the situation. What kind of peace they talking about? They're not out of their mind, these people. It's like someone still ever dreamed that one day a man and a leopard can live together in the same bedroom. This is exactly the same chance. No, one day he's going to like me, this leopard. Look, I give him this, I give him the good side of the bed, by the window, and I give him meat, and I give him massage, whatever you want, I give him. Just like me, Mr. Leopard. He can't love you, it's his nature. Hashem programmed the Arabs the day he said in the Torah, Ishmael, Pere, Adam, Yado, Bakol, Viat, Kolbo, that's it, it's not even in our hand. That's it. It's come from the blood of Ishmael, end of story. Everyone has his job in the world. Their job is to intimidate the world. Not only the Jews, also the other goyim. Why? Somebody has to be the policeman in the world. Do you know what they do in Europe? Some women in Europe, they go with the tights. You know, the mini tights attached. When they see someone like that, they don't like how she dressed, they go and bring and take it down in the street. Make her naked in the street. Something that they do now. Why? To intimidate them. In other places, when they know there's mixed beaches, they put bombs under the sand. People come to the beach, they walk, psh, explosion. Bombs, mind. Under the sand, they cover it with a little sand. You walk, explode, you lose your two legs, if you stay alive. Their job, to put fear in the world. Why? Because fear make people think about God. Oh God, oh my God. You know that in America? Oh my God, oh my God. When do you hear oh my God? Usually when there's a tragedy, no? People look at that as a political issue. It's nonsense. No political issue here. Political issue is between Argentina and England. About the Falkland Island. Who gonna own the island? Fine. Between Russia and the island, what's their name? Or the Georgian. That's political. They're both Christians, it doesn't make a difference. They fight over borders, over property, over money, over honor. That's political issues. The war between the Arab and the rest of the world, mainly the nation of Israel, it's not a political argument. It's an argument of religion 100%. It's all about religion. Make no mistakes. No one really needs the land of Israel. It's smaller than New Jersey. You know, and I know, that if a person owns the entire New York State, everything it is, and one block from here to here belongs to another block, one tiny block, will he still want 80% of that block? Come on, you cannot be that greedy. You have the whole state, we have a tiny room to stand here before we're going to be in the ocean, and you don't want to give us a few, five, six cities that we have left? An airplane, an F-16 airplane, from an Israeli military base, taking off. As soon as he take off, it's a matter of 20 seconds. In less than a minute, he finish Israel. He's already in the north, or in Egypt. In 1 minute, no matter where he is in Israel, if it's in Haifa, he takes off, in 2 minutes he's in Lebanon. Did you know that? 2 minutes. 2 minutes is in Lebanon. To Jordan, even less than that. You just take off. As soon as you finish the takeoff, you're in Jordan already. One of the pilots once told me, people don't care that we gave Egypt Sinai, the whole desert of Sinai. Most of it was not occupied. We had a few cities over there. So we gave it all to Egypt for peace, supposedly peace. So most of the Israelis don't care so much about Sinai because most of it wasn't occupied. It wasn't that you give hundreds of cities full of buildings. It's not the same. But for us, the Israeli Air Force is a very big problem. We have no place to train anymore. As soon as you hit the gas, you're already out of Israel. You don't have a place to fly. It's like you're in a box. It's become so small. You know, Sinai was bigger than the entire Israel, what they gave Egypt. The area that they gave Egypt was bigger than whole Israel. Then they gave the Palestinian Jericho and Gaza and all the other places. Officially, they gave it to them. Now they want half of Jerusalem, hoping to take the other half later. And half of the people in Israel are for it. There are many Israelis who would let them take the Western Wall. Without hesitation. Well, give them. What do I need it? No problem. Why do you complain about the United Nations? United Nations are a bunch of anti-Semites. An anti-Semite, they hate a Jew. What do you want? But half of our nation is like this almost. They give them Jerusalem, give them everything. Will they leave us alone? Will be able to live in a brotherhood? Give them. Let's stay with Tel Aviv, it's okay. What they don't tell you is that two of the Israeli politicians, righties, in Israel they keep fighting about the Sudanese that came from Sudan and smuggled into Israel. I know it sounds crazy. You have Sudanese Muslims from Sudan, coming to Israel from the fence. There's a fence, they cut it and they come in. They walk into Israel. Next thing, you find them in Tel Aviv, Be'er Sheva, walking in the street. Who is this guy? See a black guy. They all, where are you from? Sudan, Arab Sudani. Walking in Israel. It can be Al-Qaeda, it can be, who knows, ISIS. Entering Israel, can you believe it? If you think, oh, here in the United States it won't happen, you're dreaming. Everyone wants to come into America, doesn't even need a passport. You pay a few thousand dollars to the Mexican, they drive you in a tunnel into America. You come out of somewhere in the desert, you come, you take off the cover, and you're outside in America. They have tunnels. Some tunnels are narrow, you can only walk. Some tunnels you can go with a car, they have cars, they have shuttles, like in the airport. The cartel, the Mexican cartel. Trump is talking about building a wall between us and Mexico. This is all politics. The wall won't solve the problem. It will solve some of the problem. They'll go with tunnels like the Arabs go to Israel with tunnels. Tunnels is a problem. You have no solution against tunnels. The only way to solve the problem is to flood them. You bring pipes. You find out, you make holes in the ground, you drill holes in the ground. Oh, here you go. There's space. What is it? I don't even have to find the tunnel. Flood it with water, massive amount of water. Eventually, it will all collapse. The problem is, you cannot find all the tunnels. You can find some of them. It's enough, they have one or two left. They keep coming in. The Mexicans, they can come as much as they want, and probably even after Trump, they'll be able to come. But there are some other issues here. First of all, you know, I'm not even talking so much about the financial problems that we have here, that the United States have $20 trillion debt. Do you know what it means? 20 billion times 1,000. 20 billions times 1,000. Take 20,000 boxes, 20,000 boxes, 20,000 boxes, and put $1 billion in each. Do you understand what it is? Even if you want to print it, you need buildings full of machines, day and night, print dollars, you know, quickly, you won't be able to print it. Even to pay for the interest, it's not going to be enough. In Obama times, it went from 14, 15 trillion to 20 trillion. It's unbelievable. The Obamacare, total disaster. Total. It's just not working. Nobody takes it, doctors don't take it, they keep increasing the premium. It's going to be collapsing any minute, with or without Trump. He says he's going to cancel it. I don't know what solution he has, but in this country, it will be situations that the hospitals will go bankrupt. They're not going to get paid. They're already, the doctors are not getting paid. Unless you're a great doctor that you can live without insurance and people will pay you cash, all the ordinary doctors, it's not, it doesn't pay to pay to be a doctor. If your kids has a plan to go to college and then to medical school, change their mind now. Because by the time they get there, they won't get paid. People won't have money to pay them. It will become worse than Israel. How much you think a doctor in Israel make? All month works like a dog. How much you think he makes? $2,000 to $3,000 a month. That's his salary. $2,000 to $3,000 a month. What do you think he makes? Unless if he has his private clinic. Private people come on the side, surgeries on the side, that's a different story. Then he can charge thousands of dollars every week, whatever. But this is what's happening. That's what's happening. So the future of the healthcare system looks like a disaster. The financial system looks like a disaster. But what is the biggest problem? Iran is on the way to a bomb. Maximum 10 years, they're going to have bombs, nuclear bombs. The minute Iran will have nuclear bombs, you know what would happen? Same thing that happened with North Korea. They laugh at you when you tell them, stop, don't do. They laugh at you. What are you going to do? We'll throw one at New York. They have not have a bomb. Once they have a bomb, that's it. There's nothing you can do. United States cannot control them, cannot educate them. If Iran will have a bomb, you have no idea what's going to happen in the world. Whatever they do now, they'll do 100 times worse. Right now, they're still afraid not to go behind a certain line. What's the good news by having Trump as a president? First of all, him and Putin are friends, which is very important. Putin cannot stand Hillary, cannot stand her. If she would win, that means the situation with Russia would become worse every week. Because in life, it's all about personal relationship. You should know that. In business, personal relationship with your customer. Ask all the customers why they buy by this place. We like the guy. Product is the same more or less everywhere. Same bagel here, same bagel there. So why you go here? I like the guy that's worked there. Or I like the service. Or I like the owner. It's all about personal relationship. If two most important leaders in the world hate each other, even if it's a cold war, it's a disaster. Do you know what the Cold War means? That every country makes a financial horrible damage to the other. Making damage to each other. Viruses in a computer, killing spies, doing all kinds of things. Telling the Arabs about an American attack, they tell them about Russian attack. They betrayed each other. Instead of working together against ISIS, against the horrible Islam that's taking over the world, they keep selling each other because it's a cold war. They hate each other also. It's not good. We're going to pay the price. What do you think? So she would bring disaster on us just on that. What else? What else? Everyone worked with her over the years and went into a fight with her. And did she didn't like him? One by one disappeared. Did you hear it or no? You saw that video? Between 7 or 9 people that worked with her, they all got murdered or committed suicide. None of these mysteries was resolved. They're dying. Everyone was starting to fight her, or had something to say about her. All of a sudden, he was found dead. They made a film, documentary, with the names of the people, with a picture. Was found dead in his apartment in this date. This one, as soon as after he said something about her, a week later he was found dead. Mamash, unbelievable what's happening here. She didn't have to do it. All she had to do is to call her friends in Saudi. I need a favor. And they sent one of their agents. Every country has Mossad. You think only the Israelis has Mossad or the American CIA? Iran has a very sophisticated agency. They kill people all over the world nonstop, in Lebanon, in Syria. Everyone they don't like, right away they eliminate him. And everyone eliminates everyone. They all have agents. They do the job for him. Same thing the Russian helped Trump to get elected. Like I said, it's a dirty war behind. What is in it for us? This is the first time in the modern history of United States, or perhaps since United States became a country, that the President of United States says in the open whatever he wants without thinking twice, especially when it comes to Israel and the Jews. Here is some of his statement. I love Israel. I'm going to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the capital city of Israel only. Israel belongs to the Jews. Israel should build in a settlement. Do you know what it means? That now he make himself millions of enemies in politics. In every country, in Germany, in England. They're all liberals. They're all pro-Palestinian. They all hate Jews. They hate Israel. When he comes like this, the strongest person in the world, and he said, not only I will not put pressure on Israel not to expand, I will promote them to build. It's their land. It belongs to them. Not being politically correct in any subject. I see in Donald Trump a lot of similarity to the story of King David. King David, he was hated not only by his enemies, Achitophel, Shaul, all these people, his son Avshalom, they all rebel against him. He was hated by his own family as well. They kicked him out to the mountains. They suspected him that he's an illegitimate son, a mamzer. His brother sent him away. His father, Ishai, sent him away. The only one who liked him was his mother. That's why he says in Tehillim, Ani avdecha ben amatecha. I am your servant, the son of your female servant. Who? My mother. Who was his mother? Who was David HaMelech's mother? What was her name? Huh? Do you know or no? David HaMelech's mother. You know? Golda Meir. not his grandmother, his wife. He's a mother, not Golda Meir, relax. His mother was Nitzevet Bat Adael, that was her name, Nitzevet. She was the wife of Ishai. She is the only one who brought him in and took care of him and cheered him up. That's why he was faithful to her. When he wrote the Tehillim, he wrote, Ani Avdecha, he didn't say Ani Avdecha Ben Ishai HaTzadik. His father was Gdol Ador. His father was a very big tzadik. He didn't mention him in Tehillim. Only his mother. Why Trump and David HaMelech have a little similarity in their story? Trump is a person that everyone fought him. Everyone in politics. His own people, the Republican, many of them also fought him. Not to talk about not support him, fought him in the open, denounced him, declare that he's not capable of being president, ruined his reputation, refused to help him in what he needed. His own family, the Republicans, many of them, important people, turned their back on them. Former presidents, Republicans, did not vote for him. They bragged about it. The media butchered him nonstop. All the liberals, every place he went to speak, demonstrations against him. Did you see? When she came, nobody demonstrated. She didn't have anyone fighting her. Everything was legit for her. And all these people in the end against him, and Hashem helped him to get elected. Why did Hashem make him get elected? Now let's speculate. What could be the outcome now? One, you know he has a big mouth. And you know that he's not thinking more than once when he does something. And sometimes even once he doesn't think. Together with Rudy Giuliani, which also very strict, no politically correctness. He's going to try to make things right. It would bring a lot of hate and anger towards them. I also felt it over the years on myself. For what? For telling people what the Torah says. It's not a pleasant truth. They didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to hear that their end will be an eternal destruction. They didn't want to hear that God hates gays. They didn't want to hear that God hates traitors and lefties. They didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to hear that Michalel Shabbat is 100% a goy and he has no share to the world to come. The women didn't like to hear how much Hashem is disgusted by her when she walks in the street the way she dressed. That's why most of the speakers don't like to talk about these things. Even if they think the right way, they're afraid to express themselves. Here and there you find a few brave people that tried and they burned them out. I know some of them. They told me, listen, I can't even say it anymore. I tried once and twice. I almost got fired. I'm not for wars. I cannot live with the pressure. The media, the things, the YouTube, the demonstration, the dirty language. It's not for me. I don't know how you do it. That's what I heard from them. Some of them, at least one, to be more precise, invited me to his community. I'm give a lecture about modesty to the ladies here in my shul. I said, why don't you do it? What do I know that you don't know? He said to me, no, it's not about that. If I will do it, tomorrow morning I have a letter of they firing me. They're going to fire me. They cannot hear the truth from me. They're going to have to live with me in the same synagogue every day. They'll be embarrassed. So I'll bring you as an outsider. You tell them all the truth and what's going to be the price they're going to pay if they continue to dress like that. And then when they come to complain to me that you're fanatic and crazy, I'm going to say, listen, I didn't really know that it's going to be so strict. And that's it. At least I fulfill my duty. I'm the leader of the community. All their sins will be all on me if I won't do enough to correct it. But on the other hand, my hands are tied. They don't let me speak. As soon as I begin to say something, you know Rabbi Uri Zohar used to be a movie star in Israel, big one, in comedies, in television, prime time, was a host in all kinds of shows. He was even a director. He made a lot of money from movies. He was the number one comedian and actor in Israel, perhaps in all time. Very, very famous. He participated in very classical Israeli films. Until today, they show them all over. And one day, he became religious, about 30 years ago. He became religious. It was a process. Then he grew up a beard and a black hat, and he became a full-day learner. Became a rabbi, mamash talmid chacham. Slowly, cut from that world. One day, they offered him, since he's still attracting, you know, rating, they offered him to be in a show. What's the show? Conversation between secular to religious people. So they invited him to the studio. He has to tell his personal stories and difference between his world to the next world. And guess what? You know, when they invite you to the studio, they put a earphone in your ear, a little piece,
and like this they give you instructions, fix your tie, sit straight, you know, all kinds of, I went a few times to places that they film you, they put you together, no, come, and they say on a microphone, sometimes they even cut and they tell you, but if it's live, it's a problem. So now he doesn't know how to be a faker. He came now, mamash tzaddik. So when he started to talk about the Torah, right away the director was telling him on the ear, בלי החזרה בתשובה, תעצור, תחליף נושא, don't brainwash, don't talk about religion, don't talk about making תשובה. Soon as he begin to go to that direction, maybe he's going to talk about Shabbat or about Hashem, immediately he's telling him in the ear, change, don't talk about religion. What do you care I talk about religion? I talk next week, if people like it, fine, if not, throw me out. Don't invite me anymore to the next show. Why? This is a massive propaganda. The hatred of the wicked people to the people who love God. Even secular people that love God are hated. In conversation in the internet between Israelis, you have two kinds of secular people. You have secular people that say, I wish Hitler would kill them all these Haredim. And then you have other secular people that say, shame on you, it's our brothers. And then he answered, this is not my brothers. If I could kill them, I would kill them with my own hands. Why? Because the religious people make a demonstration in Yerushalayim. What's the demonstration about? That they took one boy from yeshiva into the army by force. He's learning Torah. Tens of thousands are learning Torah. They decided to take him, put him in jail. Why not either everyone or no one? Why did all of a sudden you take him? So they made demonstration. Maybe 1,000 people came, then they demonstrated, they blocked the road. This is what's happening. Every day fights. Cultural war. War of religion. There's really no freedom of religion. So what can happen? One thing can happen that is going to start intimidate the Muslim community in America. More FBI civilians. More pressure on them, more pressure in their masks, bigger punishments in court, tougher in immigration. It will be very difficult for them to enter to the country. Two things can happen, Rabotai. One, it may work. That will be a big surprise for me, that less terrorists will come into this country, and many of the ones who already live here would leave. Because they know that our hands are not, we're not free to do what we wanted. Obama days are over, that he was a picnic for us. That every time we attack, Obama was our best lawyer. It wasn't terror. There's no indication it was terrorist. It wasn't Muslims. Obama, the lawyer. You understand? So he's going to be tough, and he's a tough character. And FBI, they want to be tough. But Obama is on the red, and Hillary, and all the rest of the liberals. They don't let breathe. Same thing in Israel. The Israeli soldiers, they want to be aggressive. They don't let them. The Arab curse your mother, tell you what he did with your sister in Tel Aviv, make fun at you, you have to stand there 12 hours, listen to it, and you're not allowed to move. When he throw rocks at you, you can shoot in the air. You're not allowed to shoot at him. Only when your life is in a risk, you're allowed to shoot at his leg. Never to shoot to kill. This is the way the army is. Did you hear that? How can it not boil your blood? This politically correct system, it's such a cancer, such a poison in our society, that it's mamash the biggest threat to our world. There are millions of people like this, lefty liberals, freedom of rights, freedom of speech, everyone can say everything about everyone. Everyone is not suspect. Islam is a religion of peace. All this nonsense that we hear nonstop, hopefully are about to stop. Hopefully something is really going to change it. That's one option. The other option is, like I said once before, the Arabs are not the Jews. When they humiliated the Jews, they were quiet. When they took away their rights, they were quiet. When they started to kill them, they were quiet. When they burned them in a gas chambers, they were quiet. They stood online and went in. Nobody made a beep, not the Jews and not the world. With the Arabs, it's not going to be like that. When they feel the pressure, you have 10 millions of them here in America. All you need is 1% of them are radical and crazy. That's it. Violent. How much is 1% from 10 million? How much? 100,000 potential ISIS murderers living in this country. 1%. We know it's much more than 1%. Let's not fool ourselves. You don't believe me? Go to any mosque you want here in New York, take them out one by one, connect him to a lie detector. Ask him if his dream is to see United States goes on fire and all Americans dying and it becomes a Muslim place. Once he say no, the machine will break. All of them. Check. Pay money, do a survey. Well, who are you kidding? You still want to live in a lie and illusion all your life? This is politics. Where is Hashem here? It's very possible that Hashem did all of that to start Gog Umagog. Could be a massive war now between Christians in the world, America, combined with other countries in Europe, face to face against Islam. Not here and there, little by little. Non-stop war, massive. Or it could be that he will really move the American embassy into Jerusalem. And then what would happen? It would make all the liberal hypocrite world go crazy, include some of the Erev Rav Jews. They'll go crazy. You're declaring that Jerusalem belongs to the Jews against the United Nations decision? Against all the anti-Semite British, BBC, and France, and Germans, and all the rest, it's not going to be tolerated by the world. That can lead to a massive attack on the world to grab Jerusalem from the Jews by force. Just like the prophet Zechariah says, that all the nations will go in a war against Israel and Jerusalem. That's what's going to be. It will be for sure. When? We don't know. Maybe in the time of Trump. Maybe it's not it. Maybe it will be the next one. We don't know. But for the first time ever, we have a president that say, I love Israel. Not Israel has the right to defend themselves. None of this nonsense, political garbage. I love Israel. I have friends in Israel. Netanyahu is a great friend. We see things in the same eye. I love the Jews. My daughter, one of the happiest days when my daughter told me that she converted to Judaism, I immediately agreed. I'm proud of her. I'm proud of my grandchildren. I love the Jews. I have a lot of Jewish friends. When did you ever hear a leader in any country in the world besides Harper from Canada, that is no longer the prime minister, when did you ever hear a leader speaks like this about Israel and about the Jews? When? There are maybe other leaders who also think like that, but they will never dare to say it. They're afraid to get the Arabs angry. Why should you vote for the Jews when there are only 13 million people in the world, when you have 1.8 billion Arabs in the world? By voting for the Jews, you automatically go into a massive argument with those 1.8 million Muslims. So it's not profitable. Like Coca-Cola and Nike and Adidas, they're afraid to get the Arabs angry. How much Adidas they sell in Israel? Most people cannot afford it anyway, these kind of shoes. And anyway, from how many kids you have in Israel? 1 million. So 200,000 of them buy one pair of Adidas a year. Go to the Arab world, Dubai, Bahrain, this, add all these millions of Arabs. It's much better business. Why should we get angry with them? But he doesn't do this calculation. Of course, he has a lot to lose. by supporting Israel like this in the open, up front, even before the election, and speaking strongly against the Muslims and the murderers and calling Hamas exactly what they are, murderers, and Hezbollah and Iran. Obama ever say one bad word about Iran? One bad word about the Hamas? Did you ever hear Obama give a speech against those Muslim murderers ever? Hillary ever did? Do you see the picture how she was kissing Arafat? She almost fainted from excitement. The mouse, Arafat, and his wife, Suha.
Soha.
Soha, Arafat. Do you understand? Suha. Kif halak. Ya achli, kif halak. Hillary. The hypocrisy is crazy. Israel have the right to defend it. Thank you very much that we allowed not to die. Ay, ay, ay. You know that in Israel they do a lot of gematria, numeric value. Donald Trump came with a calculation, gematria Mashiach. Not that he's the Messiah. Messiah cannot be a goy. It has to be a Jew, a righteous Jew, someone who knows a lot of Torah, and he is from the family of King David. He's none of the above. Not a Jew, he's not a Talmid Chacham. He's not from the family of King David. So none of the above applies to him. But he can be a messenger of Hashem to start the salvation. Just like who? Like Koresh. Koresh also was a goy. In Iran, the king of Iran. Back then, not Ayatollah, Koresh. They used to have a righteous king, Koresh. Many of the Persian Jews, their name is Kurosh. Go to Great Neck, half of the guys there, Kurosh. Why they call themselves Kurosh? Nobody will call himself Barack Obama to his kids. Maybe have some lefties that will. But a normal Jew will call his son Barack Obama? No. He might as well call him Barack Osama. You know the joke that Hillary Clinton started her campaign, so she went with her daughter Chelsea to Iraq. The Marines, they all stood in line, all these machos, you know, the soldiers. So Chelsea was going from one soldier to another. So she asked them, what are you afraid of? You all heroes like this, Marines. So one guy said to him, there's anything that scares you? And he said, yes, three things scares me. What? One thing, Osama. That was before they killed Osama. He was on Iran. She said, of course, everyone's afraid of Osama. Next thing she said, he said, what? Hillary was running against Obama for the presidency when it happened. So he told her, the next thing that scares me is Obama. Osama, Obama. She said, okay, great, meaning he's a supporter of my mother. And what's the third thing? Your mama. That's the joke of the year. Tov. So it could be a beginning of a movement, of a salvation. It may take a few years, but something is about to cook. We will see. By the way, what I said before, every bad prophecy in the Tanakh doesn't necessarily have to happen. Only the good prophecies for sure will happen. The bad one can be canceled by the behaving of the people even a day before they're supposed to start. Meaning, Hashem sent Yonah to Nineveh, to the Goyim, in 40 days I will destroy all of you. That's the plan. That's a prophecy. Unless you do tshuva, that's why I'm giving you a warning. Tanakh, it's full of warnings. And they did tshuva, they changed their ways, they fast, they did all kinds of things. And Hashem canceled their decree, didn't kill them. They were supposed to die in 40 days. All the bad prophecies are warnings in order for the people to make repentance. But when the people do not make repentance, the prophecy for sure will take place. But it could be that even the majority of the nation will make repentance. It can reverse this decision. If you have in Israel 6 million Jews, altogether 13.2 million Jews in the whole world, if 6 million of them become religious, that's already the majority. No. So the majority, it's called Rubo Kechulo. There's a rule. Majority count like 100%. If you have a majority, you follow the majority. But you have a minority also, it's dismissed. That's why you always follow the majority. Also in the Torah, Yachid ve'rabim, halacha ke'rabim. That's the rule. You have a mixture from the Torah. If something impure got mixed with something pure, and the pure is more than the impure, it's already kosher. The chachamim, the rabbis, they made a fence around this law to make it a little bit more strict, that people will not make mistakes when it's 50-50. They say it has to be 60 times more, batel b'shishim. Meaning, it can be no more than 1.6% in a mixture. Meaning, if you have soup that is 60 ounces of soup in a bowl, and a little piece fell in, which is half an ounce, it's no problem, it's kosher. But what happened if 1.5 ounce fell in compared to 60? That's already more. Up to 1 versus 60, that's the cutting line. More than that, meaning more than 1.6%, right? If you take 100% and divide it to 60, it's 1.6%, approximately. So if it goes more than 1.6% in a mixture, from Rabbanan, it's not allowed. Not allowed. Makes it not kosher. From the Torah, it was allowed. Why? Even 60-40, it's okay. Even 51-49, it's okay. In Sanhedrin, they have 71 rabbis and prophets back in the time, they had. When they reach a decision, that's why they have an uneven number, 71, an odd number. 71, why? That you always have a majority. So meaning 36 against 35, that's it, the 36 won. Unless if it's a matter of life and death. You cannot execute a person with a one vote different. 36 against 30, not enough to kill him. But 37, you know, if you take 37 versus 35, then it's fine. You understand? So the point is now that I'm saying right now is the majority according to the Torah count already like the entire thing. So if the majority of the Jewish people will be Shomer Shabbat and righteous and learn Torah, that's enough to prevent already a massive tragedy. What would happen to the wicked people? When Mashiach come and there will be the salvation, they won't be there. Hashem will clean them from the world sooner or later. But it doesn't have to be a massive war that all the nation of Israel will have to suffer and run away like it described in the prophet Zechariah, Zechariah 14. Doesn't have to be like that. Now it's an opportunity, once the strongest person in the world is not politically correct, and he say it as it is, whether you like to hear it or not, is hated by the media, will all kiss up to him now with their fake hypocrisy. They will all kiss up to him, but he's not a fool. When it comes to this, he knows exactly who is with him and who is against him. So the point is, since he doesn't care about them so much, he may make some changes here. Maybe something in this country is about to change. Better judges in the Supreme Court, not all these liberal lefty Jews, Obama style, all of them. Maybe finally we're not going to have corrupted judges that make gay marriage legal. Maybe the Iran agreement will be canceled, which is a big risk for all of us, because it leads them mamash to a bomb. You know one thing, I don't know if you know it, they published a few days ago that Israel already had a plan attack to attack Iran. Everything was ready to go. The planes were ready. The units were ready. The air force were ready. The rest of the soldiers, everyone, they trained on that for a long, long time. Bibi called Barack Obama. He was in his plane when it happened. He said to him, we are going to attack Iran and we'll destroy their nuclear facility. If things will escalate and they will retaliate, we will need this kind of weapon. Are you with us? You going to support us? Can we rely on you or no? What did he say? What Hussein say? What do you expect from Hussein to say? Absolutely not. He didn't give us Apache missiles for the helicopters when we fought the Hamas. He didn't know Hamas are murderer organization, terrorist, but he didn't know. He didn't give us. Why you sold us Apache airplanes if you don't sell us the weapon? Imagine it's like you have this Game Boy, Game Boys that they sell for the children. You need cassettes, CDs, I don't know how you call it. This is the games. So the company sell it, and there's no way to buy the games. Come on, we want to buy the games. No, we don't make games. No, we don't sell to you games. So why did you make me buy the game, the whole thing, the unit, if I cannot buy the games? Any questions so far?
Do they make their own missiles? Will Israel make its own missiles because they're pretty good technology?
Israel is very advanced. But, and they make a great progress in many, many fields, but there are some things so for whatever reason they don't make. First of all, missiles Israel do make. They have, it's called Rafael, they make missiles, yes. But they don't make all the missiles that United States have. Remember, here it's a country with 400 million people. Israel is a small country, there's only 6 million Jews. And, you know, you need enough people to be able to make cars and make planes and make... You need a country like Russia and America. The more people you have in a country, the more things you can develop. It's worth it for you. But Israel has the best brains, meaning they have the biggest inventions and the biggest discoveries. All kinds of robots, spying equipment, satellites. They make, Israel makes satellites. Israel also made a war airplane similar to the F-16. It's called the Lavi. It was finished. That's what they already had, one plane finished, flying. Unbelievable war airplane. United States put such pressure on Israel, they forced them to destroy the plane to make airplanes. That will be the end of America. You know how many airplanes they sell every year to the world? Constantly, every 5 years, 10 years, countries buying airplanes. Each airplane is $50 million. Each F-16, $50 million or more. Some airplanes, $200 million. The F-35, more than $200 million a plane. And they crash in training sometimes. You need new ones. In Israel, they just had a plane crash. In America, F-35 just crashed a few days ago. $200 million damage. Israel can make everything they want. They can even make cars. The question is it worth it for them? That's the question. You understand? They have now in Israel the technology that they can basically make anything they want with the Israeli innovation, with the electronic level, with the electric level, with the computer level. You have the best brains in the world sitting in Israel. No wonder Apple and Intel and Microsoft and a lot of other companies, they all open huge buildings in Israel and they hire Israelis because they give them the most advanced inventions. It's very interesting. Not only that, you know, the Israelis are also ahead of everyone, maybe together with the United States, when it comes to weapon and to civilians and spying equipment and security. They have Israeli private companies in every country almost, in South America, in Brazil, in many places, that they supply security to even to governments. They will secure the next Olympic Games. They will secure embassies. they're very, very advanced.
Israel were competing with the United States about selling missiles to India. Ask about missiles. India. It was hundreds of millions of dollars deal. Hundreds of millions of dollars. The Indian wanted to buy it from America. You know, it cannot compete with America. They can cut the prices. Israel, to a certain price, it would not worth for them to make it. So America was about to win the deal. Guess what happened? The last day of the war between Israel and Hamas until they had ceasefire, the last war, the Israeli got stuck without missiles to the Apache helicopters, like I told you. They called United States to make an order, send them quickly. We need them. They didn't know they're gonna have tomorrow a ceasefire. It was massive war going on. They said, Obama said, I will not allow you use our missile to attack Palestinians. The Indians saw that. They canceled the deal with America and went with Israel. Israel got the deal. The Americans were furious. Why did you do that? They told Obama, we cannot rely on you people. You are like snakes. You dump your allies in a minute. You did it to Mubarak in Egypt. Now you did it to the Israelis. Tomorrow, when we're gonna need from you weapon and more, you're gonna tell us the same thing against Pakistan. You're not reliable. You only do what's good for you. You don't care about anyone. It's not like the Russians. Why the people that go with the Russians never leave them? Did you ever ask this? Ask yourself. Once the Russians sign with you, no matter what kind of Hitler you are, they're behind you no matter what. Iran, they know Iran is the danger to the whole world. They never turn their back on them. They never vote against them. Syria, Assad, mass murderer, gassing his people. The Russians are not happy that he gassed Syrian people. Well, of course they're not happy. Assad was one step already out of his office. Putin sent an army to put him back. We never turn our back to our friends and those who do business with us. We're not the Americans. It sends a signal to the rest of the world. Why should we go with the Americans? They sell us in a minute, based on their interest in the field. We'll do business with Russia. Guess what happened now? The Saudis were selling oil to Egypt. Oil, gas. They stopped the oil, they closed the pipe. Egypt doesn't have oil now. Egypt, 80 million Arabs live in Egypt. They stopped the oil supply. Why? They're not happy that Egypt is not helping Saudi in Yemen and in other places. You're not with us, we don't sell you anymore. What Egypt did, went to Iran. Iran is dying. Iran was about to go bankrupt completely. That's it. They wouldn't have what to eat. People, the shelves were all empty in a store. You cannot buy anything. Nothing, no medicine, no food, no clothing. Mamash, they were finished. They dried them out, the sanction. Obama released $150 billion. They were frozen in America. Put them back on their knees. On their feet. Now Egypt will buy oil from Iran. Russia made a huge weapon deal with Iran. Iran becoming one of the biggest empires in the world. They control the Middle East. They literally occupying Iraq as we speak. They occupy Iraq. They control Syria. Now all you need is Iran taking over Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Abu Dhabi, and Dubai, those places, which will take a few hours. They don't have army to fight. They can take them over in a day. And that's it. Iran become much like Russia in America. One of the Midrashim said that the end of the world will start from Iran, from Persia. The king of Iran has a dispute with the king of Arabia, Saudi Arabia. It escalates. As they're all trying to negotiate a deal, boom, a massive war starts and the war comes to an end. Massive war, big war, Gog and Magog. That's one more option.
So basically, conclusion. Every day that we are alive, it's a miracle. From the amount of dangers out there, ISIS are now have control in 38 countries. 38 countries, ISIS controlling cities, areas. Mamash, they have the people, they took over the control, they check in houses, they collect tax, they rob the people, they rape the people, they put people in jails, they control the jails, they execute people in Iraq, in Syria, in many places. ISIS is mamash, a massive army all over. What an organization it became. ISIS has more power than many of the countries in the world. They are Denmark. They don't have the power that ISIS have. They have a much massive army, all volunteers. All volunteers. I want to ask you a question. Why an Arab from Europe that goes to university or has a job, he lives in Germany or France or Belgium, would live his comfortable life in Europe and would go to Syria to fight? Why? What are the reasons? Do you know that one Jew approached me that he went to Kurdistan to fight with the Kurdish against ISIS? As a result of that, he cannot enter Israel. The Israeli don't let him in. They're afraid. He came to me if I can help him to get into Israel. Use my connection there with the government to get him in. I'm nice, I'm a Jew. I said to him, but what went into your mind to go and fight with the Kurdish people? So I feel bad for the Kurdish people, everyone kills them. Everyone has a mission in life. He decided to be the Messiah of the Kurdish people. I almost asked him, if you want to be such a Santa Claus, why don't you go to Israel and fight with Israelis against Hamas? Maybe they won't accept him. Over there, everyone is accepted. You don't need to be a soldier. You come, they train you 1-2 days, yalla, I give you a weapon, go fight. No, let's hear if you know the answer. Why people would live their comfortable life and become warriors, jihad? They go to Syria, fight for a few months, either they died or they come back to the country. Why? The most common reason, Islam. But wait a minute, it's all Muslim against Muslim. They all kill each other in the name of Allah and Muhammad, no? So why he decided to join ISIS and not Syria, and not Assad, and not the rebels, and not Al-Qaeda, and not Iran? They're all Muslims. So you have Shiites, you have Sunni, okay, but even Shiite and Shiites fight. You don't know anymore who fights against who. So why would they go and fight here and not here? It's very strange. Second reason besides Islam and believing that they go to heaven, it's the women. Women. Why? You can rape women as much as you want. You have a weapon, you come to a place, you see a pretty woman, you take her with a weapon, you rape her. Every day as much as you want, nobody cares. They rape people, ISIS, everywhere, nonstop. Read some of the stories, the horror over there. So he wants to do it, so for that he goes there. What's the third reason? Money. They rob people. You fight with people, you kill someone, you take his watch, you take his gold, his money, his cash, his phone, whatever they have. It's a lot of things. You get tons of things with you. Lots of cash, sometimes drugs. They rob drugs, they rob oil. They share between the warriors. They rob oil fields worth hundreds of millions of dollars. There is a film that United States bombed a building that ISIS took over. Millions of American $100 bills were flying in the air. They bombed it. You saw that or no? All over, like snow. $100 bills. Billions of dollars in that building ISIS had. Stored. In one building. Imagine how much cash. Imagine how much they put in a pocket on the way back to Belgium or to France. Not everyone is such a tzaddik. In the name of Muhammad and Allah, wa la 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 la. You understand?
I want to conclude. The world has come to a point of no return. You don't need to be a genius to understand that. In morality, the world has declared a war against Hashem. The majority of the people in the world are God haters. Even though they won't, some of them won't dare to say it or to pronounce it on their lips, but their action proves that they hate God. Why? They promote gay marriage. It's a direct war against the creator of the world. They direct all kinds of other sexual crimes. They support corruption. They live with many of the things that is against the Torah, 100%. They want to eat whatever they want. They want to do whatever they want. They want to watch whatever they want. They don't want anyone to tell them in the name of the law, of the Torah, of the religion, anything. People cannot be rebuked. They cannot stand Musar. So the world has come to a situation right now that is mamash a disaster. The marriage institution in the world collapsed completely in the modern countries. All the modern countries, Europe, Israel, America, and other countries that are advanced, the marriage institution is in a total bankruptcy. The education system is in a total disaster. The drugs epidemic in every one of the countries, with some exception to the rule, reach numbers that nobody ever heard. Drugs epidemic, so many people are dying from drugs every week, you have no idea, in our communities. One kid that we raised, even in Monsi, was in good yeshiva, became a heroin addict. Today my wife told me, don't ask, he's wanted by the FBI. He's a fugitive. He's facing many years in prison. What did he do? He needs heroin. When you need heroin, you sell your own mother, your killer, for the drugs. I'm not exaggerating. You don't know what it means when a person needs the drugs. They'll kill anyone, his own kids. He'll sell his kid for drugs. If you come and tell him, I'll give you drugs for 10 years, give me this baby, he'll give the baby. He won't be able to take the pain. You have to see them when they get arrested by the police and they put them in a cell for a day or two until they see a judge. You have to see what's happening to them. How they shrink and they scream and they go crazy and they freeze and they have all this, I don't know how even to describe it. Unbelievable what these drugs do to these kids. So how did he end now? He's being a fugitive, the FBI is searching for him, his pictures are all over the media. He's wanted, wanted, the kid that was in yeshiva. He tried to smoke. Rabbi, it's only smoking. Unfortunately, many times the smoking leads to other things, many times. And then one time they tried, you're done. You're either gonna die or you end in jail. That's it, there's no other alternative. Very few comes out of it, percentage-wise, 5%. The rehab, I spoke to one of them, sending a kid there. What's the chance to get clean? 5%, he said. Between me and you, Rabbi, I don't wanna BSU, that was his word. 5%. 5 out of 100. Don't believe that they tell you 50%. 5%. I work here, I know. 5% will get saved. And maybe they'll go back to it later on. For now, they'll get saved. 95% will either die or be in jail. Be in jail in America, you know what a day in jail in America is? I'm not sure what's worse, day in jail or day in hell. Gehenom. All these gorillas over there, the guards, they abuse people. No idea what's happening in jail. We had one guy in yeshiva, Baal Tshuvah, that was 46 days in jail. The stories he told me from jail, I became depressed just from his stories. He told me 46 people in a room, the bathroom in the middle of the room, no doors. You have to sit in a bathroom and 46 people are looking at you. Do you understand what a nightmare or no? For $1 million a day, would you agree to be there? sit in a bathroom and 46 strangers looking at you, a black, a Puerto Rican, a German, American, whatever, all looks at you like this. You have to sit in a bathroom. Imagine the rest. The America, civilized country. There are places much worse. In India, when you walk into some of the jails in India, no one comes out of there alive. No one. Everyone dies there. I saw an article about one Israeli guy that escaped from the jail. They took him with an ambulance to a doctor. He broke a window over there. He ran. Miracle after miracle Hashem did to him. Escaped from there. It was supposed to be 20 years in prison there. He would be dead for sure. So no one comes out of there. 30 people in a small cell. Rats like this, size of a watermelon, walking on people's head. No bathrooms. People make in the middle, on the floor. In India, that's how it is. In India, people live on a sidewalk like this. People live on the streets like that. Not only in jails, it's like this. It's horrible, the things that happen over there. So I say the world that came to a no return situation. The ideology of the world is totally rotten. The electronic, the smartphones, the computer, the pornography, the education of the children, the drugs epidemic. That's it. To fix all of that, it's impossible. You can save some people from it. Mamash, like Tevat Noach, like Noach's Ark. You can make some Balei Tshuva that will be great and live according to the Torah. Here is a family, here is one, here is two, here is three. That's it. That's what we're fighting for, to save some crumbs. The war is finished. Please don't kid yourself. Until Mashiach would come, the war is over already. That's it. Now all we have to beg Hashem that our children will stay religious. Forget about Gdol Ador, Talmid Chacham. This is all illusions. If your kids will be religious, it's a huge achievement. You have four kids, five, six, seven kids, and they all be Shomer Shabbat and believe in Hashem and go to Shul. Oh, you won not the lottery, 15 different lotteries you won. I remember 20 years ago we had dreams. Wow, my son will be Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul. He will be Rav Eliashiv. He's learning good in yeshiva. 20 years later, you see what happened to the world with the internet. There's not one day, not one day, I don't get at least one call about one chassid. On purpose I say chassid, because they are the most strict in their lifestyle when it comes to holiness and kedusha and religion and devotion and, you know, very strict. They dress like this, they don't care, they isolate themselves from the world mostly, at least most of them. As now one day I don't get a call from a chassid, from the most important families in the Jewish world, that the husband left the family, became an atheist, left his children and his wife and became a goy. Or ran away with goya, or a woman that met a goy and ran away from him and left her husband and children alone. Every day at least one case, at least one. Then you understand where we live. So this kid, FBI is following him. You know what he did? He went to a place, he got a job. First day on the job, he found out their checkbook. He wrote himself a check for $100,000. He sneaked into the receptionist room, there's a check. He forged the signature. He saw, I guess, some checks over there. He copied the signature, deposited it. All of a sudden, they see $100,000 went to his account. He took the money for drugs. What do you think he took the money for? Not to buy a car, I promise you. Only for one thing, to survive another day. To survive another day. Once you're already in it, it's very hard to judge a person. It's really not fair to judge him. It's not even him anymore. It's mamash not him, 100%, it's not in his hand. I'm telling you, he will kill his own mother, so you're talking to me about money. Nobody wants to kill his mother, right? For the drugs, they will. I remember when I was a kid, I had one
far relative, far, very far. Once every year or two we saw him. One time I heard that he was under heroin influence. His mother had a gold necklace, gold. And he wanted her to give it to him. She phoned him. He beat her up. He made her eyes blue like this. He took the necklace from her and sold it for one day drugs. That's it. Just to give him one day. You know, people took advantage on him. And then another case with him, they used to have television. Television was very expensive in Israel, like $3,000. You know, the big fat one? Not like today, it's all flat. Big one, and if it was with color, only the rich people had it. He actually took it for one day of drugs, he sold it. Until his father died from a broken heart, from what he saw with him. And then the mother died a few years later. What was the end of this guy? After being in jail on and off for 20 years, somehow he came out of it and became open a rehab for Israeli addicts and became a millionaire. Got some horses, bought himself a ranch, the government pay, the insurance pay, the family pay. It's, by the way, the best business in America is rehab and old age homes. The best businesses in America. If you have extra money and you want to invest, that's what you should do. Used to be pharmacies, but now with the new things, it's not anymore any, not so much. Pharmacy used to be very good business, especially if it's in a good location, all kinds of AIDS patients, each one spent by you $2,000 a month for their medication, their juices, all kinds of vaccines. It's not such a great business anymore. I hear, you know, I talk to people, the people call me, they consult with me. So from here I learn what's happening in the world. From inside, not from the media. The media, they sometimes baloney, they write. From the actual street, if you see three different owners of pharmacy who used to boom, and now they tell you business became very hard, it became like this, it became like this, the Obamacare, the insurance. Then you understand that it's no bargain. Same thing doctors. Doctors used to celebrate. Now they all cry, almost all of them. Well, what do you see? It doesn't pay to be a doctor anymore. Best businesses, rehab. Every heroin addict, how much they pay a month, do you know, for rehab? $30,000 a kid, a month. Sometimes $80,000, depending on the treatment. Some rehabs will take 10, 7. One way or the other, it's a fantastic profit. There are a few people, they pay them a nice salary, no problem, they have a building. It's all come from the insurance company and from their rich parents. Poor parents cannot send their kids to rehab. They either die or they end up in jail. The rich ones, the movie stars. You know, I have two guys from California. They came here to New York. They're friends of my, sons of my friend. And they listened to my lectures and they got all the friends in Beverly Hills over there in LA to listen to my lectures. Apparently, who are the friends? All the movie stars' children and the NBA stars that lives in LA. The son of Shaquille, the son of this movie star, the son of this the rap singer. All these people are their gang. So when they came to my lecture in Brooklyn about 2 months ago, after the lecture, we took them out. We sat in a place to eat something. I asked them. So one of them told me, my friend is not a Jew. He is addicted to your lectures. His father is the biggest lawyer in America, lawyer of Obama even. He's the lawyer of Obama. He Googled him, so he sees, hugged with Obama. He listens to you all day and all night. I got all our friends to listen all day. So I asked them, tell me, all these goyim, they take drugs? They say, no. I say, no? What do you mean, no? Say, their parents, they put bodyguards on them. It's full follow-up. Make sure he goes to the club, is a gorilla watching what he does. Make sure he doesn't touch drugs. They finally found a way, the only way to raise a kid in this world, I pay a few $1,000s a month, make sure my son will not become a crack addict or coke or heroin. Worth it for me than to lose a kid. Otherwise, for sure, he'll be a drug addict. This is what they told me. I never heard of that before. So they know, first of all, they need bodyguards anyway, these kids. They're afraid that someone will kidnap them. Imagine your father worth $500 million. They kidnap the kid, man. Like in Mexico, Jews go to school. When I was there, I didn't see it. But I heard it from stories, and they're not denying it. That you want to send your kid to school, they have a bodyguard standing by the class. Why? They already kidnapped a few Jewish kids in a Syrian community. They ransomed millions of dollars to release them. You know? Imagine you live in a country, you're rich. What you make in a day, the average Mexican does not make in 30 years. What a successful businessman, Jewish person in real estate in Mexico makes in a day from his buildings, from the rent, an average amigo doesn't make in 30 years. How much an average Mexican makes? I ask them, I say, how much is this policeman makes? All day he stands in the sun and direct traffic. All month, from morning to night, in 100 degrees, $500 a month. And that's a good salary. Some make $300 a month. How this conversation came up? I asked my host, what happened if we get pulled over? He laughed. It will cost us $5. Ma? Why? He comes to give you a ticket, he say, como esta senor? Give him $5. Oh, Dios que bendigo. $5 for him is a whole day work. He doesn't even get to his notebook. That's how they solve problems in these countries. Hard to believe what's happening here. Mamash like this. They call banana republics. Republicat bananot. I don't know where they came with this expression from. Meaning it's shaky, shady. Everyone bribes everyone, everyone blackmail everyone. All corruption. Same thing in other countries, India, those places. What do you think? Time came to an end, and I have another lecture now. Any questions before we finish? Very informative and very shocking. And opening the eyes of the people. Maybe now the liberalism and the lefties and the haters of religion and the people with a corrupted mind will lower their profile, will not control the media like they used to. Maybe things will change. Maybe we're naive to even think so. You know? We'll see. We'll wait and see to see what happened. By the way, just that you know, I'm sure that many of the statements he made towards Israel and the Jews, he meant it 100%. But it doesn't mean he'll be able to do it. Even as the most powerful person in the world, the President of the United States, it's not so simple. Because sometimes there are threats, there are people that quit to fire, to quit. You don't want to lose him. If you do it like this, if you move the embassy to Jerusalem, we're going to resign. All kinds of things like this. You know, what you want to do, like they say one time, what you see from here, you don't see from there. Right now you attack the prime minister because you're here. When you become a prime minister, you see things from there. Believe me, many of the things you thought it easy is not so easy. I say if he does 50% of what he promised, it's already going to be 100 times better than Obama, which everything he did was bad. Everything. I don't think he did one good thing. I'm talking towards Israel, towards only bad. Bad with Iran. He revived Iran. He failed in his war against terrorism. The economy is horrible. The debt grew up by another $5 trillion. Gay marriage became legal in many states in America in his time. Horrible things happened. He allowed Musk next to September 11, next to the twins. Over there, they built Musk. It's like laughing to the victims in their face. They murder their dears in the name of Islam, and over there they make masks in his time. He was supporting it. His healthcare failed. Everything he touched became a curse. Everything. And what's going to be his reward? He's going to retire now, play golf, play basketball, what he likes to do,
and make $200,000 per lecture, like me. Finally, I woke you up after $200,000 for Obama and Hillary and Bill and George. That's what they make per lecture. This is the words of the Gemara. Alma de Shikra. Even an orange or a tomato I wouldn't give them for a lecture, for their nonsense and corruption. But this is the way it is. The biggest rabbis in the world will come to talk for free, and the most corrupted people in the world will get $200,000 for 45 minutes nonsense that they're gonna say in Goldman Sachs office. Right or wrong? Baruch Hashem. At least the next one won't be so corrupted. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen.